when it came to being was gone. The British government was British. Then, in 1689, they had much to claim the plans of others as a family, and the province took more credit for victories than was due to them. At the same time, Montgomery was an outstanding military leader, with a record in the war of 1880 by the Allied commander. Montgomery had already proved his promise during the evacuation of Dunkirk in 1940, and in the brilliant scenes of victories in the Desert of Northumberland that began with all London in 1942. Yet he was also capable of making unwise choices. Later on, in September 1944, he clashed with Eisenhower and the Americans over their broad front strategy, and the narrow front, the front of the first into northern Germany, would keep it. If Montgomery had had his way, U.S. General Patton's Third Army would have been robbed of supplies and support. Eisenhower put his foot down, and a broad front strategy prevailed. This, though, was not the first time Montgomery's tactics were called into question. 3 months earlier, his plan for capturing Caen became the subject of serious criticism. General Montgomery, a senior major of Overlord, commanding the German Army Group B, and his opposite number in the German front, were established rivals for the time Air Force units in Normandy. They'd already faced each other in North Africa, where Rommel's dynamic temper and talents of daring innovation had attracted the respect of his British opponents. At home in Germany, Rommel was tailor-made to be a war hero. Not only was he immensely likable, but the dominance in the desert he enjoyed until late 1942, and the way he consistently outwitted the British, generated great excitement in Germany. The desert was pure battlefield, with few, if any, civilians, and no towns or even villages, and Rommel was well suited for the fluid, fast-moving warfare that the land had. But Normandy was completely different. Much more conscripted, and even more importantly, much more under the control of Rommel's own supreme commander, Adolf Hitler. Hitler had never been all that keen on the desert war. The main reason he allowed it to continue was Rommel's popularity and the enthusiasm for the war it created at home. Rommel, however, had an invaluable trait for a Führer who always respected men of ambition. He was a military commander, pure and simple, and had no unions for political power. If anything, he was politically naive, and that suited Hitler's fashion. Even so, it was a serious weakness for the German cause in Normandy to have military strategy in the hands of an incompetent like Hitler, who paid more attention to his own fancies than he paid to his commanders on the ground. Hitler's lack of military knowledge had already been responsible for the disaster that overtook the German armies in Russia. Rommel himself had been hampered in North Africa by the lack of military support Hitler had allowed him. Hitler knew nothing of the principles of strategic withdrawal and how it preserved forces to fight and possibly win another day. His answer to untenable situations was that Germans must never retreat, but fight to the last man. It was little wonder that the Führer was the despair of his generals, who had to follow orders however impossible and go on fighting battles and eventually a war they could not win. Rommel's growing reputation preserved him from dismissal, Hitler's usual response to protest, but he was not spared the other drawback created by the Führer's scenario for Normandy. Once the Normandy landing had succeeded, the next task of the German defenders was to stop the army from expanding the beachhead, and therefore prevent them from reaching Caen. It was clear that Caen was the next and logical target, and heavy air raid by 600 aircraft of the 8th US Army Air Force swept the town at 1500 meters on D-Day. Caen was transformed into passive and sinking rubble. Meanwhile, out at sea, Allied ships crossed the Caen. However, the delay experienced by the British in setting out from the coast to attack the Caen gave them valuable time to organize an iron wing defense. The Germans put three divisions in place to form a screen around Caen. The 21st Division, the 10th SS Panzergruppe Division, and the Panzergruppe. And the Canadians remainder of 7th June will find it in conflict in General Montgomery's strategy for Caen was largely conditioned by the plan to take the town on D-Day. His forces, therefore, were going to make a front attack. This, Montgomery expected, would take them through the town and pass the position to make an effective Montgomery soon ran out of and the field of the German resistance began to desperate forces. This led to a speedy change of plan, definitely more effective and hopefully less costly. On the 9th of June, Montgomery conferred with Lieutenant General Thomas Gentry, U.S. General Omar Bradley. They agreed that instead of a head-on assault, Caen would be enveloped, with the British Second Army keeping up pressure on the town, while pushing towards the Eberbach, Eberbach, and then only fighting towards Falaise. Pressurizing Caen in this fashion would also serve to divert German attention from the main efforts to capture the important port of Frederick. By coincidence, the same day, Lieutenant General Leo Gray von Frederick, commander of Panzergruppe, unveiled a new plan of his own, a concerted push in which the three divisions, Sword and Caen, would prepare to draw their forces, but after the plan was amended by Rommel, would have been separated from the British. What the other side had realized was that their plans had to be followed out, with only one possible result, a direct clash all along the battle line. The Allied troops belonged to a force headed by a unified command, with Allied dominance in the air to protect them, and a strong, if slow, build-up of men and armament to reinforce them. These were important advantages, and ultimately, they were crucial. However, among the Allied commanders there was a belief, endorsed by British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, that the situation in which the Germans outpaced their opponents. Whenever Allied forces confronted the Germans in action by equal strength, the Germans normally prevailed. Just how frequent that equality would be was an unanswered question as the Battle for Caen got underway. On the Allied side in Normandy, the predominant tank was the American German Air Corps. A large number of Germans, 49,320, were taken out when actually began the activity. The most abundant tank of the land. Compared to the British, some German tanks, the Germans gave them 5 to 6 miles per hour. They were actually more limited, the thickness of its armor fell below that of the British rifles. The Sherman, which weighed up to 32 tons and was powered by 500 horsepower petrol engine, carried a 76mm main gun, replaced by 1 12.7mm and 2 7.62mm machine guns. And a two-inch mortar. It had a range of 100 miles and a fully transversible turret. There were drawbacks, though. The Germans' profile was vulnerably high, and its armor was too weak to withstand much of the Germans' anti-tank fire. It was virtually helpless for the pressure of the German anti-air. After the critical loss of British armor and weapons suffered at Dunkirk in 1940, a replacement for the Matilda II tank was urgently needed. The first tanks were available within the year, 1941, but it took another 12 months to sort out the inevitable fuel problems. However, by March 1942, the 6-pounder gun was at last available to replace the less effective carrier tank chassis. After a disastrous failure during the Road of the Earth in 1942, and the protest of the tank on a single beat, the tanks went on to prove their ability. their maximum 102mm armor also proved relatively impervious to different counter-attack cannon. The Turkish carried a 6-pounder main gunner and two 7.92mm cannon, depending on the slope type, with a maximum speed of just over 15 miles an hour. But it tended to falter at high speed, and its sabre engine proved unreliable. As a result, the Typhoon suffered too many accidents to continue the run. Towards the end of 1942, the Typhoon was restructured and equipped with a new 2,180 horsepower Napier sabre engine. The new Typhoon possessed a maximum speed of 412 miles an hour, a flight ceiling of 32.5 feet, and a maximum range of 510 miles. It carried a 1,000-pound bomb load and 400 meters of cannon. After its makeover, the fighter bomber reemerged to become the terror of the Union Army, and eventually formed the offensive fire of the 2nd Tactical Air Force. Although their bomber was dead, the numbers were relatively small. 3,030 Typhoons were manufactured between 1942 and 1945. The Germans were classed as the underdogs in the struggle for Caen, and the Allies tended to presume that their military capability was in the same state. They were certainly very serious problems. The German 7th Army in Normandy was overstretched. They were constantly harassed by the French resistance. Air cover from the Luftwaffe was virtually non-existent. Losses were difficult, sometimes impossible to replace. Allied air supremacy tortured the troops on the ground. On paper, the Germans seemed to have everything stacked against them. In fact, their military capability was much greater than this suggested. Many of the German commanders in the field were brilliant operational leaders, able to make the most effective use of their strength. Some of them, like Major General Kurt Mayer, commander of the Hitlerjugend division, led from the front and personally inspired their men by their talk. The long-standing German military tradition ensured that they were highly motivated, whatever the odds. And many of the German units comprised in weak bodies did not shrink from sacrificing themselves for fatherland and Führer. If anything, they embraced it and equated such sacrifice with glory. The Allies were called this attitude for now. The Germans, it was no more than their duty. The German 88mm flat gun, might be evidence in the Battle of the Battle of Caen, was one of the most powerful and most effective guns in the Second World War. The 88 was originally designed for anti-aircraft defense. However, when some of them were converted as anti-tank guns, and still held to the patriots in North Africa in 1941, the 88's reputation was destroyed. Normandy was the perfect setup for the 88. The Normandy blockade offered maximum chances for cannon fire in the 88. It was the same as the many fortified villages where the 88 was fighting. When mounted on the flank, the early appearance of the 88 was startling. And I too discreet at its 16-foot-long barrel, as long as a telegraph pole. This unusual length made the muzzle velocity of the 88 extremely punishing. Firing at 85 degrees elevation, the 88 used armor-piercing huge shells that moved at 886 yards per second. They could hit their target and create firebursts at distances of up to 2,000 yards. An experienced crew was able to dismount the 88 and be ready for action in no more than 20 seconds, then remount the gun to move elsewhere in less than 60. The Tiger II, or Panzer VI, was a tank equipment for the 88mm gun. Like the 88, the Tiger was a superior and superior weapon. The because of the tank's exploits in Normandy, it was still being used by the Panzer there. Allied troops came to those with three planes or four churches, but needed to challenge one plane. Then, the German tanks were disposed of most, if not all. Designed as a heavy breakthrough tank, the English troops and other division, the Tiger II weighed a heavy 75 ton, and its power base was 290 kilos per engine, with a maximum speed of 24 miles per hour. Even the Russian T-34 had to close to just over 1,600 yards before the fleet penetrated the target. Understandably, Allied tank crews generally preferred to outmaneuver the tank rather than confront it and approach it from the rear. Nobelwerfer, meaning smoke spray, originally applied to German chemical monitoring. Later, the Nobelwerfer became rocket launch, specifically the 150mm 41 model, which had six launching tubes. Fired at ranges up to 7,700 yards, the Nobelwerfer 41 launched its incendiary rockets in sequence to avoid being intercepted by the blast. Meanwhile, the Nobelwerfer's crew had to circle in its tent at least 15 yards away as the rockets were fired inaccurately into the gun support. The whole launch from the Nobelwerfer, including loading, took 90 seconds to complete. The sound was terrifying, and the high-pitched screeching. For the Allies, the Nobelwerfer was a truly great one. It was reckoned to have caused three-quarters of the casualties in the battle. For the Germans, the Nobelwerfer helped them cope with a serious problem of infantry and artillery frigates in the latter part of the war. The Germans turned instead to mass Nobelwerfer, which was especially effective in putting out defensive fire. The 185th Brigade received the first cut of their Tower 7 as the attack was. Attempting to force their way through the east, northwest of Caen, they soon found that powerful supporting batteries were not enough to prevent them from suffering huge casualties. The brigade stood ground to a halt. The 9th Brigade did somewhat better at Caen, which they had given up in the world of the rifles and had dropped by the first 8 years a mile and a half of ground without cover. The Germans put up such a holocaust of fire that the Ottomans suffered very heavy casualties and the advance got no further. The 7th Army of Army Group B, whose task it was to defend Normandy, placed its strongest forces around Caen. coast to be protected by static positions, filled in the main with men wounded in battle, too old to fight, or prisoners from the eastern front, with supposedly volunteer the 21st Panzers, the Panzer Corps, and the 12th SA Signal Movement Divisions, which faced an iron ring defensive command camp, were much more elite forces. They were imbued with self-sacrificing loyalty, and the resolve and skill to fend off the Allies, no matter what the cost. One of these divisions, the 12th SA Hitler Unit, the Hitler Youth, belonged to the Waffen SS, and comprised the most militarized teenagers in the world. Like the rest of the Waffen SS, they were volunteers. Familiar with weapons since as early as the age of six, the Hitler Youth had been reared for war and revolted. Despite, or perhaps because of, their extreme youth, the Hitlerjugend typified fanatical, light-spirited resistance more than any other German division in the world. Both the Hitlerjugend and the Panzer Regiment had been thoroughly funded by Allied aircraft as they moved out towards the core of the region. The Panzer Lehr had left behind a trail of burned out, bullet-ridden weapons that included 130 shells, 5 tanks, 84 guns, and a strength car belonging to its commander, the Field General Fritz Bauer. As an elite, however, the Panzer Lehr had been given the most up-to-date equipment, including the incomparable Tiger II tanks and the Panzer or Panzer Horror, which outclassed but did not replace the German Panzer IV. The Hitlerjugend, in full battle strength, was 21,286 men, but always been treated as special. Later on in the Battle for Normandy, in mid-June, Adolf Hitler himself sought to preserve what was left of them by ordering their withdrawal. At that juncture, the parlous state of the Hitler Youth and the two other divisions displayed the grim truth about how they had fought in the first week after D-Day, and what it had cost them. The fighting at Lebice and Caen on the 7th of June gave notice that the early battles for Caen were going to be struggles to the death. This set a pattern that was to be repeated in every ferocious encounter that took place around Caen at the next 7 days. On the morning of the 7th of June, the 9th Infantry Brigade Group, the forward troops of the 3rd Canadian Division, were advancing towards Catastrophic and its airfield, which was sighted west of Caen. Meanwhile, behind them, more Canadian tanks were moving southwest from the direction of Boulogne and headed for Olty. The Canadians passed through Olty and set out for Falaise Gap and Catastrophic. There was no apparent opposition, but it was there nevertheless. The progress of the Canadians had been observed all the while by the 12th SS Hitlerjugend Division, which was under orders to hold their fire until the right moment. Major General Kurt Mayer, leader of the Hitlerjugend, chose his moment carefully. He waited for the Canadian tanks to pass through Falaise Gap and reach the point where they were just about to cross the road between Caen and Falaise. Only then did he get to hear the word. Surprise was complete. Tanks were blown apart from the close fire. The crews jumped out to save themselves, but ran into a hail of shots. Recovering, the Canadians returned to him, and the Panzer IV was hit. Flames funneled up out of its tower. Pushing through the smoke and thunder of combat, the Canadian infantry tried to force their way into Orton, only to find that Germans wanted to. In a subsequent manner, the Germans seized control of Falaise and Orton and started pushing back the Canadian forward unit. The Canadians reeled under the impact, but the Germans didn't have it all their own reason. Violent fighting raged all over the surrounding area, and when the Hitlerjugend 1st Battalion, which had been delayed by refueling problems, arrived in the suburbs of Caen, the Canadians were waiting for them with German tanks and heavy machine guns. The Canadian artillery opened up, and Allied aircraft weighed in with penetrating bombing and strafing units. The Panzer IV were outnumbered. They could do nothing to stop the Germans, and eventually the Germans were forced to retreat. After the furore of battle died down, the Canadians came off with it. They lost 245 casualties and 28 civilian tanks. Although the Hitler Youth could congratulate themselves on their handling of the Canadian challenge, Kurt Mayer was not content to rest on these laurels. Early on the 8th of June, he ordered the 26th Regiment of the Hitler Youth to advance across the railway line between Bavaria and Caen, taking the 6th Canadian Armored Regiment, which had captured both the Yorkshires a few hours earlier. The Canadians were now poised to capture Catholic Hill Airfield, but the 26th Regiment got in the way, and the airfield remained beyond reach. Meanwhile, the 7th Canadian Brigade came under heavy attack at Poutot and Bavaria. This prompted a speedy counter, with the Canadians making mammoth efforts to retrieve their positions. At 8:30 on the 8th of June, Canadian infantry and tanks were at a wall of fire with heavy machine guns to their front. The 26th Regiment was caught without anti-tank weapons and had to pull back on the nearby railway line. By nightfall, Poutot was ready to continue. The pattern was much the same that rocked in the Moon Valley close to the Caen Valley of Rome, with Germans and Canadians quickly followed at point blank range. But more even they could, and the men were battered, in fact, all over the battle area. Whichever side managed to advance did so through a storm of fire. Attack forces, renewed, all to begin. Games were made and lost and improved. Here and there, tanks on fire blazed their flames into the sunny sky. Some of the crew burned to death in the fire. Dead soldiers slumped in ditches, or they scattered across the field. This attrition cost the Canadians nearly 3,000 casualties in the first week of the Normandy campaign. Afterwards, they consolidated the positions that had been so dearly won, but got no further. After 4 days, General Montgomery was forced to realize that assaulting Caen head on was futile. The casualties had been too great, and Caen was no nearer to being captured. The solution would not be easy, especially when Montgomery's new plan for the government people came to end on the 8th of June. Going to the German offensive, if he had done the same day. In these mutually opposing fields, the British 50th Division and the 2nd Army Division, the Desert Panzer, moving out of Bavaria to take Villers-Bocage, was going to be opposed by the Panzergruppe, advancing from Villers-Bocage against Bavaria. In the centre, the Hitler Division were to advance north of the Caen Valley of Europe, and the Canadian 3rd Division would be the south and south. The British 51st Highland Division, advancing out of the bridgehead east of the River Orne, was going to encounter the 21st Cavalry Division moving into it. General Montgomery, appalled when the losses suffered so far, desperately wanted to deploy more of the same. In the event, more of the same was inevitable. The Panzer there set off along the road to Bayeux, escorted by Marne. But they got within only 3 miles of the Caen when they were suddenly recalled. An emergency had suddenly arisen at Lamini and Patrick, a weak point in the German lines, where the Canadians were plastering quickly in the position of possible. The Canadians, for their part, were unable to battle the heavy machine gun mortars, and eventually the Canadians were forced to repair, leaving behind 37 tanks and 95 dead. As the Bavaria on the 10th of June, the authoritative German armor ordered to take the city ran into a powerful stream of AI and sank by the Navy Corps of the Canada. Bavaria remained in Allied hands. The Panzer there were now ordered to defend the Caen system against the British 2nd Armored Division, which had advanced out of Bavaria. Caen's hill, which was already in ruins by the time the Panzer there arrived, led to the valley to the southeast of Caen. This is no place for mobile warfare, but Bavaria was in order to defend the Panzer there. The Panzer there's tank was then set up as a mobile phone, but by the time it lasted a week, it was only a few more seconds to get through. Caen was quickly to secure the mark that captured the when the fighting got underway, it soon resolved itself into a series of vicious formations. even for this. Three of his four tiger tanks were destroyed, and his own was brought to a halt, and his tank was blown off by a 6-pound British anti tank gun. Two more tigers were destroyed by PIAT projectiles. Livery and his crew managed to escape, but they left behind them 25 ruined British tanks, 14 carriers, another 14 half tanks, and several hundred British dead. That evening, the Germans were able to seize and hold the Eber Canal. The damage Wittmann had done and the shock he'd administered to the Eber Canal had serious consequences. The British drive to Caen, which had begun in such exhilarating need, had been stopped cold in its tracks, and the Germans had managed to close the last important bastion of battle line. Early on the morning of the 14th of June, the 7th Armored Division disengaged and withdrew to positions east of Caen, 3 miles away. With this, a week after D-Day, the early phase in the battle for Caen came to an end. In the immediate aftermath of the early battles for Caen, both sides were utterly exhausted. The tank crews of the 7th Division were so tired, both physically and mentally, that many of them remained asleep throughout the withdrawal to Caen, and didn't even wake up when they reached it. The Germans, and particularly the Hitler Youth, were in a similar state, but they at least had the satisfaction of some success. They had not only closed up their line, but defied all efforts to be destroyed. Grievous casualties had been suffered on both sides. It was reckoned that the 6th Canadian Regiment alone had lost one-third of all their casualties in Normandy in a single engagement at the Memorial Platform. As for the Germans, one of their battalions, the 25th, was reduced from 700 officers in men to 539. And in the lull that followed the Eber Canal, they lost a daily total of one or two dead and 12 injured and nothing but death in the continuing naval and air bombardment. The Allies' failure to capture Caen in the first week of June 1944 was more than just a note in the eye of the Normandy campaign. The town's strategic position and the role it played as guardian of the route east of the north of Germany meant that it could not be bypassed or isolated or simply marooned behind the enemy's field of defense. Even in its ruined state, the air raid was in the region and most three-quarters of the town was destroyed, Caen remained the hope. Or failure in Normandy. Plans for the American conquest of the Cook Empire and the subsequent breakout from the beachheads depended on its capture. A key component of General Montgomery's plan of attack had been to pin down the German army at Caen, to give the Americans a better chance. But the events of the second week in June had shown what it would cost and how much of that strength would be diverted if this failure had not taken so long. But since then, the capture of Caen was not only the new in Western Europe. The questions, the doubts, and blame arose out of the fighting around Caen after D-Day, sent it first and foremost on the overall plan devised by General Montgomery. Workings of personal feuds would make him clearly explain why his plan came out of the way. Partly this was due to the flexibility of Montgomery's style of leadership, while the deal was not easily accepted or taken. The deal made the round point and employed unacceptably high casualties. In the Allied ranks and officers' ranks, he was allowed to express the risk of Montgomery's strategy. No one saw his impact on the team. that the evening went in rumble and the saddle continued with the lightning and water. The channel went down to the cross. The paddle shifted and the answer was always the combat. Hitler was directing the travel from his wolf lair at one point in the east Prussia, with no means of observing it or not. He promised Lowell really important, but Lowell knew perfectly well that they would be understood and understood. What Lowell really wanted was more personal control over the war, and the authority to order retreats as necessary. Hitler refused. Managed to receive the backing of their superior, Field Marshal von Rundstedt. But when he telephoned Hitler to put the proposal to him, he was summarily dismissed. The venerable Field Marshal was replaced by 62-year-old General Field Marshal Gunther von Kronach, whose view of Germany's war prospects was extremely pessimistic. Von Steppenberg was also replaced, and though Rommel survived, most of them still kept for the future as a new tip to the the Allies must take the Germans must defend themselves.